We should get this thing rolling, though, if we're going to make the most of the time we have.
So. We only have 40 minutes at this point.
Are you kidding?
So, okay. For starters, everybody, welcome to the Soulbrandt E3 podcast. My name is Franz, a German spy. We also have here today actual Soulbrandt members, Jerp, Frosty, Ty, Brandon.
Hello.
Dave is honorary.
No, Soulbrandt now. Let's answer right now. This is the big announcement.
I don't know where I
figure in. That's what this is actually about.
We have Trent.
Hello.
Peeve.
Hi.
And special guest Terramantis joining us.
Hello.
All right. So yesterday, we had the privilege of seeing the first public live demo of Dark Souls 3.
It wouldn't really count as public at this point, would it?
Well, public as in they released it to somebody other than internally.
Oh, that's
closed doors.
Yeah.
So I get semi-public, whatever.
As public as it's getting.
You all know what we need. True. So we're here to share our impressions, basically, in the fairly limited amount of time we have before we get kicked out of this conference room.
Oh, boy.
So who would like to start then? I mean, what are the important issues here?
So Miyazaki's way taller.
Obviously
the
frame rate issue. I mean, that's probably the most important thing that ever told
us. Oh, yeah.
I mean, the frame rate.
He was
what else?
Like, how tall is tall?
Yeah, 35 frame rate.
The resolution on all platforms. These are the important things.
Here's a picture next to him. He's about the same height as me. He's 5'10", I guess. Like, yeah, 5'10". He's about 5'10".
He's still pretty tall for a Japanese guy. Go to Japan, see for yourself.
Yeah, so let's talk about the video games.
Alright, Dark Souls 3.
Dark Souls 3 looks exactly like Dark Souls 1.
Right.
It looks and plays just like it seems.
I was watching from the beginning just trying to decide if it's Dark Souls 1 movement or Dark Souls 2 movement, and the moment he like sprinted up the stairs, me and Ty looked at each other because like the running animation, it's like 100%.
There are a ton of reused animations from Dark Souls 1, definitely not Dark Souls 2, and that's a good thing because Dark Souls 1.
That parry. That backstab.
Parries are back to what they were. So
but
you
I thought it.
You repost an enemy and it's going to be a stab through the stomach instead of knocking it to the ground and dancing around for 5 hours.
But the point is, it was the exact same.
There were a couple minor tweaks to some of that, though. First off, is the one that did when the backstab actually occurred. When it was the parry actually occurred, there was a little bit of snapping to it. It was somewhat. It felt almost reminiscent of Demon Souls, where everything wasn't really perfectly paired together.
That could just be the alpha, though.
That's what I'm thinking. The other thing is that the greatsword, they had the animations were similar to like Dark Souls, but there were some tweaking for the behaviors. It's very subtle stuff. It's mostly the transitional stuff. Especially between swings, if you're comboing those swings.
So fun.
That's what made me think of Bloodborne, though. It seemed way faster and snappier than any Dark Souls
before. No, that's good.
It seemed like it had a great weapon stances.
Aside from the jittery frame rate, which is because some of it was 60 frames, some of it was below 30, but it was just like a tech demo.
It is.
It's going to be locked at 30. Aside from some of the jittery frame rate, it ran like butter. Like everything seemed so much smoother than all the Souls games. Well, other than maybe Bloodborne, if you consider that. So it looked as refined as Bloodborne, minus the frame rate.
Yeah, Bloodborne may be a good benchmark for that, though, if we're talking about
next-gen action RPGs.
Yeah. What they did with Bloodborne, they also were doing with Dark Souls 3.
Yeah.
It's like the same quality throughout.
Mm-hmm.
And even whenever it was like the particle effects, like the fire and the explosions and the smoke, it really didn't stutter at those parts. It was just like awkward transitions, but it was like little minute things.
And some of the Souls games would, if you were too close to a blood spatter or whatever, coming out of an enemy, like the game would just chug or fog for Bloodborne especially.
Mm. I just love how the first thing that came up was FPS.
It was
a guy being like, I like it without the HUD. It's like, how did you even get in here?
That was
like,
the only for you guys listening, we had a Q&A session, and one of the questions was that there was no HUD while they were showing it to us, and someone was like, hey, it looks really good like that. What, like, can you do that now? Can you, like,
you should do that for the game.
Can you turn off the
selective rendering technology?
He didn't. He started by saying, is there going to be a HUD in the final game? He asked that question, and that's when I'm like,
His second
hub journalist who played an hour of Dark Souls.
His second part of the question was,
I just wish there was like an option for this.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. He said, I think it looks better.
Yeah. 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 This is how the final game should be.
Never gone into
Miyazaki
options,
himself
right.
was like laughing. Was like, you can disable it.
He did say confirmed there will be an option to turn off the HUD.
Oh, there you go, guys.
Confirmed. We're here first, guys.
Confirmed.
I actually found out for Lobos, when I talked to Miyazaki, that you can also, they're going to have an option just like Dark Souls 2 for jumping.
Jumping is also L3.
Right, you'll have an L3 option. So it's an option that you can do it the same way as Dark Souls 2. Right. So I like the fact that it does have the same amount of customizability as Dark Souls 2 seem to have.
Yes.
But it definitely plays and feels like Dark Souls 1. Well, we haven't played it, but it looks exactly like Dark Souls 1.
It seems like they're using some of the technological benefits. The engine is probably closer to Dark Souls 2 than
it's probably Bloodborne, I'd say.
It's probably Bloodborne.
Well, not necessarily, because there were a couple things. Well, first off, they emphasized the DirectX 11 stuff, like, in the same manner they did when they were first talking about Scholar and the DirectX 11 version. But there were a bunch of little quirkiness that the way that the cloth responded felt more like the Dark Souls 2 behavior, just like little things like that. It definitely doesn't necessarily. Obviously they're working with similar versions of that technology for Bloodborne or Dark Souls 2.
Cloth was one of the points that they specifically mentioned in the demo.
They had some really strange bullet points. In the slideshow they showed before us, similar.
Like
they picked out very specific.
Well, they wanted
stuff.
To make sure it was a point that it's still sticking to those core Souls things that they've always pushed for every single game.
Cloth physics
achievement through victory or whatever. Yeah.
Can I also point out they've made a specific point again? They're like, look at the torch and the lighting you can use with the torch. Yeah. They actually showed a torch in
Nights because this time they're not going to release it with no lighting.
But it worked very well.
It worked very well when I saw Dark Souls 2 a couple of years ago at E3.
Yeah.
But
that
I mean,
was the demo.
But Bloodborne, it works, so there's no way it's not going to work. It'd be ridiculous if it didn't.
It's probably going to look just like that. Right. If not
Scholar better. Had all the lighting things that they meant to release initially. So if Scholar has that, it would blow my mind if Dark Souls 3 was released with less than Scholar.
Well, especially considering that Dark Souls 3 was in development for how long, did we discover?
2 years before Dark Souls 2 came out.
2 years.
To clarify for our listeners, they were working on Dark Souls 3 a year before they started on Dark Souls 2. So it's had about
a year before they released.
Before the release.
I was like, how is that possible?
Yeah, they're
let's start working on Dark
Souls 3.
Final Fantasy timelines here.
Well, everyone will be able to pick this out, I hope.
As far as Miyazaki's involvement goes, he confirmed during the Q&A that he's doing the level design. Level design for this one.
Everything we saw in the distance, every building, they're like, you can go there, the exploration will allow you to go there. And correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't he even say, every building we
every
saw
building.
Was able
you
to
could
be
go
explored?
The design philosophy for this game is full exploration.
But
a tower in the distance if you can't get to that tower.
Get to it and get inside of it.
Well, it's also just from watching it, because we were able to see it, you can tell right away that it has that vertical level design that was missing in Dark Souls 2, which was so horizontal. It's very horizontal mixed with your climbing on ceilings and roofs and all that.
Right, yes, some platforming, definitely.
I'm sure so many people, when they first got to Anor Londo in Dark Souls 1, were quickly disappointed when they realized that this
it's like a straight
city
path.
They couldn't get to most of it.
Some tower, a church, and another tower.
Yeah.
But you get to climb on buttresses.
Use the word buttresses.
Exactly.
That's like a big claim, though, to be able to you see that and that. Yeah, I'm skeptical too.
It's super optimistic, but at the very least, what you can take away from it is going to have that same kind of big cohesive. World.
We know what
here's a good point to mention it many times. I would be skeptical as
well. He drove it home pretty hard.
Seeing that with him in the flesh, I don't think he's making claims that they're not going to back. It felt you know, the fact that he brought it up three or four times, he's like, you know, yeah, those towers, you can go in them.
Because it seems like anything he can't do, or that, you know, or he's unsure of, yeah, he'll be like, you know what, we can't talk about that.
No,
so,
I don't mean to say that I'm not hopeful, it's just, like, it's a big so thing. Crazy yeah. If they manage to pull it off the way they say, like, yeah, it's going yeah. to be unbelievable.
Well, the development time for this game is going to be, by the time all is said and done, they're saying it'll be released early 2016, which, let's face it,
that'll
means
be
March.
That'll be mid-March.
March, because fiscal quarters, and that's what they've done with the past three games. But my issue, I think, is, and this is Peeve, something you and I have discussed before, I'm almost afraid to be hopeful just because the past Dark Souls 2 especially has kind of made me second guess my own opinion on the matter. And I mean, from what I saw yesterday, this is looking a lot more promising than Dark Souls 2 turned out to be.
But I mean, like, when I played Dark Souls 2 at E3 a couple of years ago, it felt different to me. I was like, I actually wasn't even sure if I liked it all that much the first time I played it at E3. When I saw this right away, I was like, oh my god, this is Dark Souls 1, but like, so Dark Souls 2 automatically felt different when I first played it.
To be fair though, we didn't actually get a chance
to
play it.
No, but I'm saying even watching it, like, even just watching, you can kind of just tell.
Yeah.
But something that I find interesting was that during the Q&A when we did it, he was talking about the interconnected level design and how it's going to be like Dark Souls 1. When I interviewed him later that day, he said he compared it to Bloodborne, and he was like, well, it's going to be like Bloodborne.
Well, Bloodborne had fantastic level design.
Oh, it does, but I'm saying that there's going to be a hub, like, main safe place like Bloodborne.
Yeah. Like a Nexus.
Right.
But I mean, wait. Firelink Shrine.
So like
Firelink or
everything's interconnected
Majula.
In the world itself, but you have a safe place to go to.
Yeah. Is it really one you work from, or is it one that you actually can walk from?
Yeah,
given that this game, the world architecture seems like it's Dark Souls 1 to the core, I suspect it'll be something like Firelink Shrine.
Or Majula.
Yeah.
So like instead of the Hunter's Dream and the Nexus,
what I'm saying
though is like Firelink Shrine.
He specifically compared it to Bloodborne.
Yeah.
He said Bloodborne was the example.
There'd probably be somewhere you teleport
somewhere.
Yeah. Right, that's what it makes it sound like.
Somebody
asked. You know, like Demon's Souls is like you have different areas you can warp to that are very separate and disjointed.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whereas Bloodborne has the interconnected world design, except for that you have a safe place you warp to. So that might be the case.
I see what you're saying. Just something I wanted to touch upon. I didn't see. I didn't see.
You're wearing glasses too. Shut up.
Yeah, but mine don't have a camera. Dave, you're.
Sorry.
You did like the interview and you already uploaded it and everything.
Yep.
Because right? Somebody
pretty
mentioned that you touched.
Yeah,
see, I didn't see it. I didn't see it. But
thanks.
Somebody mentioned that you touched upon the bell, maybe.
Oh yeah, yeah. I was like really. I mean, we already. It sounded like we already got that during your own Q&A.
Yeah, you
I think
that's, yeah, that's what my question
yeah.
like, in the thing was asking, and they didn't really like.
No,
give
I mean
me
he said
that
they were like. No, it's like Dark Souls 1 and 2.
Okay.
Thank
okay.
God.
Oh,
so no bell maidens is what it definitely sounds
okay,
like.
So
he said there were soapstones.
Yeah.
Since
he specifically
don't have a lot of time,
oh, yeah, no, he said
since
that.
We don't have a lot of time, and even though I'm the last person on Earth who would bring this up, we should probably mention something about
lore?
The lore and
yeah.
the snippets of how there's a mechanic now that the little gravestones are
well,
really
actually,
better.
Actually,
no.
actually
had
a theory about that.
Yeah,
well,
I didn't understand
should,
the
so we should talk about what we do.
I completely
forgot. There's a lot of people listening that are like, what about the lore?
I agree. We should probably stick to the hard facts and our observations, what we saw.
Well, I mean, look, for that, like, it's like a lore node in Bloodborne is what it seemed like. He was like, everyone's going to have a different piece of lore to it. So, like, there's these gravestone things that you can activate that are new. I mean, we should explain because people
yeah.
haven't seen it. So
things
you activate
the
gravestone on top
of the messages
bonfire.
That you would find in
Bloodborne.
In Bloodborne,
but
yeah.
he was saying that it's going to have lore snippets for it, and we actually
yeah.
saw a lore snippet, and Ty pointed this out, I think, when you guys were talking about it yesterday. I saw on Twitter that it says a Lord of Cinder.
Oh, no.
I think you're making that
well,
point.
The, well,
yeah.
the,
they
yeah.
confirmed it's not.
Yeah,
the
keyword
for anyone
is
that's listening, the big giant guy at the end of the trailer is considered a Lord of Cinder. So whether that has any link to, like, Gwyn, Lord of Cinder, or whatever, or maybe Gwyn was a Lord of Cinder
yeah.
in a previous...
Right. Yeah,
well,
I actually...
So you asked him about this specifically, didn't you? You clarified this?
Yeah, I will ask him, like, just because I wanted to get it for an interview question about Gwyn, and I was like, does that mean since Gwyn was the Lord of Light and now the Lord of Cinder relates to him, and they said that there are many Lords of Cinders, like, there's Lords of Cinder, and that it has to do with the people who are linking the bonfire.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So,
technically,
if you ever link the bonfire, you're a Lord.
Yeah, but anytime you ever send in the cycle, you have another one of these guys. Yeah.
Right, so that's why there's
mm-hmm.
multiple.
That's why there's
yeah,
a
I'm not saying, like,
so we're going to be trying to kill our player characters
I,
from old
yeah,
games.
I read, and I don't know if this has been super confirmed or not, but I read that they did say that it's, like, not going to be the last one in the series.
but it, this is going to be like, yeah, see, but I'm, that's what I'm saying.
Did he not say it's not?
I'm quite certain I heard him say that it was the final entry.
No, well, I remember when those guys were interviewing us yesterday, they asked us, didn't they?
Yeah, yeah. During
so, I mean, that it's not, interview,
it's
they
not,
were
it's
asking.
Not the final game in the series. Miyazaki confirmed for himself. I read it.
I mean, it's also like,
but you read it, but was
yeah, it was him.
Yeah, but what was the source?
But the point,
it was like PC Gamer interview.
Yeah, the point I was getting at is they said that it would be.
Yeah, it was.
They said that in the confusion lied in the fact that it was a it's a turning point for the series. So maybe like the Lords
so
of Cinder come up and that's what it's going to be.
Well, they,
actually,
I'm okay with that.
Horizon Zero Dawn Dark Souls.
He said he was interested in like sci-fi.
It's going to be a crossover with Armored Core.
I hope so.
Yeah, finally we'll get a new Armored Core.
I want a Chrome House too. Chrome House 2 is happening in the Dark Souls universe.
Okay, so
something...
No, you go ahead.
Okay. Something I was going to touch upon that we were mentioning earlier is whenever you are saying it looks like it's a lot more fast-paced, I think it's the same speed as Dark Souls 1. It's just the enemies are so aggressive that the player, the guy who was playing was actually really good.
Yeah.
And he was just reacting really quickly and like dodging through everything. So
yeah,
I don't think it's
he
like increased.
Yeah.
Yeah, but yeah. It just looked really fast paced. But I've seen an equal speed of that pace in my only Dark Souls 1 playthroughs and stuff, where something intense starts to happen, you start dodging.
There's a part where I did a forward roll and it looked like the exact same animation as the fast roll from Dark Souls 1.
So here's the hilarious thing for me. Like last night, I made a huge post on Reddit about my impressions and stuff, and Scott John basically kind of asked me some stuff about it, and we were talking about how there's this different feel to the roles in Dark Souls 2 and Dark Souls 1, and I thought there was a big timing difference in that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah,
but
I agree.
We actually, he made a video, and it shows a direct comparison between the two, and the actual timing of every single step is exactly the same. The duration is the same.
It's just that it feels different.
Yeah, so what happens is the Dark Souls 1 animation, he kind of jumps a little bit higher, it's a little more springy, and he gets up from the roll a little bit faster. Definitely. So like even though the timing is exactly the same, those little
like there's more you know what I described?
Yeah.
He jumps like a
it's
dolphin
like a
hangs, hangs for a
it's
second.
It's a composition, but it takes the same time.
You know what I wish I'd asked?
No, even the timing, like where they're actually tumbling is the exact
I'm not sure I want to know the answer to that question.
I actually like ninja flipping, but just for the aesthetic.
We need one conversation.
It's just specifically that I wanted to look like that.
It's way too hard to listen to multiple things. Yeah, so you were saying, yeah, so he made a direct comparison between the two kinds of
well,
games.
Well, yeah, but it, like, the whole point was that, you know, it was so surprising to me because it's such an incredibly small thing. Like, there were four frames in the entire thing that were, like, a little different.
Well, I'll say from watching all of the rolls in the thing, it was definitely the springy hang
yes,
time
absolutely.
Roll. So it is the exact roll
yeah,
from Dark
yeah,
Souls
it
1.
Looks like...
And, so, I mean... How many of us were there who have played thousands of hours of the game and looked at it? I think we can say 100%
it's
the same.
It was Dark Souls 1.
That's my main. That was my main.
We never got to see Min or Fabul or anything like that. So
yeah.
I mean, I think that's a great point though, Ty. Is that like we're all people who like I think all of you would agree watching it looked like Dark Souls 1 and not Dark Souls 2.
Yes.
Watching
so,
it, like because and we're definitely people who've played enough of it that we could like make that assessment just from viewing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Apparently, Dark Souls 1 entirely.
Fextra Life said that it looked like Dark Souls 2.
Yeah,
I don't know what they're basing
that
off.
That was.
Yeah, they said it was obviously Dark Souls 2. And
I'm
like
what?
No. I'm
like,
whoa,
what are you watching?
Didn't one of the review sites say something about omnidirectional rolling? Like,
it
was obviously four-directional, the stuff that we had for Demon's Souls and Dark Souls
I
1.
Mean,
like,
I'm not going to confirm or deny that because I couldn't tell myself.
Yeah, what I'm saying about omnidirectional rolling is that you can roll and then immediately attack in any direction.
Yes, your control for your character is 360.
But they're talking about diagonally rolling.
Is either left, right, forward, back.
But that, when you're locked on, that's such a specific thing because it doesn't matter. When you're locked on, you're just trying to
you know what though? Actually,
way away.
That's why I don't lock on in Dark Souls 2. I hate that.
Yeah.
It bothers me.
Yeah.
Dark Souls 1, I lock on all the time. I stop.
But in Dark
Souls
2, if you roll past someone unlocked, you can't hit them.
It helps me unlock.
That's what I mean by omnidirectional.
Yeah.
A lot of people they want to know like, do we fight locked on? Do we fight unlocked and stuff? And
For
this game, unlocked works just as well as locked on. Roll and swing behind you.
Something else I wanted to touch on because I'm confused myself, and this is something I'm kind of worried about. The scimitars, they're For anyone who doesn't know, they had a weapon that they picked up is like dual scimitars. Like
the Legion scimitars,
the Legion scimitars.
And it's,
well, the thing is, it's the icon shows two scimitars cropped together. Someone asked about it, and it was confirmed by Miyazaki that's how it's going to be in the game. And the thing is, whenever he picked it up, he had a shield out, he had one scimitar, the other was on his belt as if it was like his offhand weapon. And then he pushed a button, and almost like he was switching to it. But the thing is, it's like two weapons that are like locked in together.
To a single slot.
Two weapons you can't separate.
Yeah, right. So it's like...
They're technically one weapon.
It's kind of, it reminds me of like trick weapons.
A lot of it is like trick weapons.
Because they have different stances.
But my concern is they now have the different stances, which is essentially transforming your weapon like in Bloodborne. So do you think they're going to have like two-handed weapons?
No, in my opinion, I think...
Or is it going to be just like Bloodborne?
I think Miyazaki or whoever was in charge looked at power stancing from Dark Souls 2 and thought, this is awkward holding a button for a few seconds and going into this slightly...
Yeah, and it like looked all like...
He's like, instead, let's just make it, you know, some weapons have a crazy two-hand, like, fancy-dancy...
Well, yeah, I agree.
But the question is there going to be two-handed weapons?
Yeah,
What we're used to is two states, either the one hand or the two hand, or in Bloodborne you've got the unmoved mode and the trick mode or whatever, right? This is going to be three. You have the one hand stance, the two hand stance, and then whatever the
that
special
was, fighting arts.
Right.
I don't know.
That would be a
I don't know about
it is,
that. Are you sure?
Yes, because the
can
long
you two hand
sword,
those
yes, the long sword.
He two handed the long sword.
Yeah.
And two handed the great
when
sword.
When he was using the long sword,
yeah, I know.
He had the regular one hand swing, and then he went blocking and parrying and stuff one handed. Then he went two handed.
Yeah.
He was attacking and blocking two handed.
Oh, I know this
and
sword.
And then he went up like this.
Three. There were three distinct ways to attack.
You think that stance is also in dual wielding? Because I think it's a two hand stance for that specific double weapon.
I don't think it's always a stance, because if you look at the greatsword, what the greatsword did, it was a one-handed,
yeah,
it was a two-handed,
and
then when you press
stance.
That, well, when you press a special button, he does that lunge. Yeah.
But he only did one attack, and then he was done.
The lunge was like a start of a combo kind of thing.
Yeah.
So you could lunge and then do the R1 attack, and then lunge and do the R2 attack. So
I think it's just that the dual scimitars, instead of being able to two-hand it,
you pull
out a second one.
Yeah, exactly.
To be fair,
he never two-handed the scimitar.
No, he never
so really, this is speculation.
No, that was the question, but I think I just realized something while we're sitting here. Isn't it possible that they took Bloodborne's mechanic of like the guns only being able to be in the left hand, and they replaced that with shields?
There probably is no left-handed weapon that is what you would consider to be your primary weapon. It's going to be shield, potentially, I guess, bow.
Does that mean like I can't have like a Zwei hander and an offhand random dagger?
I think it's the case. Are
they reserving the left hand slot for like strictly shields?
No.
Dude, also keep in mind in this alpha, did you notice when you picked up stuff, there's no menu adjustment. It all just went into the slot.
Oh yeah, he had it equipped already.
I think that was pre-equipped just for the
But what I'm saying is I don't think they're going to suddenly only they're going to restrict certain items for certain slots.
I'm saying
that was Bloodborne.
They might do that with the shields, because like how else would something like the two-handed blades work? Because they're tied together, and then like the stances, how are you going to have that work?
Well, but you mirror it.
You have a shield in one, and then you pull out, put the shield on your back.
That is like my main concern.
Yeah,
we don't want
to talk too much, because a lot of people have no idea. They never saw it, and we're not really explaining it very well. But maybe we should move on to something that we can actually explain visually.
I think something that we should really talk about that we haven't touched on yet is the new stance, because that's the new battle stance that we kind of briefly touched on now, and the fact that people have been asking me about this too, because I didn't ask about during the interview, and they're like, why didn't you ask about it? It's because we got to see it.
Yeah.
So they have this new stance, which is a combat stance, and every weapon seems to have a different special. Like, I think it was a greatsword or maybe the long sword that had like a guts attack stance where you get into the stance.
He specifically said guts.
Yeah, he said guts.
Came right out and said, yeah, this is based on guts.
Yeah, you kind of hold it over your shoulder and like point the blade.
Oh, no, right. That was special.
That was the great sword.
He didn't do that with the long sword.
No, that was the great sword.
That was the long sword. The great sword was the one that was the lunge stance, which is the one he said.
Yeah,
that
pulled it out in front of you.
That was the long sword. That's what I'm just describing.
The point is, though, that like every weapon is going to have a different one, or at least like maybe it'll be weapon classes that have different ones, but it's mainly just an extra attack mode. So it's not like this new form of combat, it's a new attack that each weapon gets to have.
Yeah. Basically, instead of in Dark Souls 1 where like you two-hand a weapon and you hit L2 and you're blocking, but not many people like use that. And some you hit L1 or L2 and you block both of them. One of those buttons, I think it even said L2 in the controller thing, goes into the new stance.
And we don't know if it's a toggle or a hold.
Well, did you guys see him kick on accident?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Like that wasn't he wasn't trying to do that. You could tell.
And it was the exact kick from Dark Souls 1.
Yeah.
Which is good. I'm glad that it wasn't that super awkward, stupid greatsword shove from Demon Souls.
And you like that not to slap your face.
Yeah, I hated the Dark Souls.
No infinite headbutts.
I'm coming to slap.
Well, we didn't see him with only fists equipped. There might be a crazy new moveset for bare hands.
So to finish with the whole sword arts thing, it appears that charge attacks are how you break shields in this game. So, because one of the problems with Dark Souls 1.
What do you mean by charge attack?
The one to hold down, charge up attack.
Like R2, I'm just trying to specify for them.
Okay.
It's not like a Bloodborne charge.
No, it is. It's right on the loading screen where it showed the controller. It says hold for a charge attack.
Oh.
Yeah, that's what. And you notice, well, we noticed, the viewers didn't, but at one point, on several occasions, he would charge up this big, slow stab with like a greatsword or whatever.
Yeah, he canceled
it in one instance.
He canceled.
Yeah. He rolled out of his own stab. Like, as he was going in to just, like, dunk the enemy, he rolled out of his own.
You know what was really cool, though, that they did, and a lot of people wouldn't have appreciated, I feel like, except for people like us, was that every time he got a new weapon, he just started showing off the moveset while Miyazaki was talking.
It was like one of us were doing it.
And it bears mentioning, the moveset of the Legion Scimitars, those dual scimitars, in their dual-wielding stance, 360-degree attacks in the entire combo.
Very
fast.
Like 1080 attacks. He was spinning like over and over and over and over.
There was one part where he killed like five zombie dudes at once.
I saw three. It was like there was a threefold attack.
It was spun three times.
It was crazier than the Gold Tracers. There was a situation, and I think we were the first ones to see this because Miyazaki said that the guy demonstrating it died the past two times they tried.
Yeah.
He charged into a group of enemies, and they got up, they all swarmed in on him, closed in. He backed off a little bit, waited till they opened themselves up, dashed in, used a spinning combo from the scimitars, hit all of them in a 360-degree radius around him, and killed them all.
Yeah, that's like what Steve was mentioning with the five at once attack.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Another thing too, though, that I thought was really cool is we saw an enemy transform while he was fighting it, and it was almost like an abyss type of thing.
Yeah. It was like the abyss took it over and changed it into like a Manus type creature.
A much larger, like this was what at first glance was a small and fairly weak enemy that was surrounded when the demonstrator approached it, surrounded by a black cloud. The black cloud then grew into an enormous boss-sized enemy.
And it attacked so frequently.
It looked like
it was like a mini boss.
It looked like
one of the mini-boss.
Honestly, reminded me of like Resident Evil 4 guys, like just all that crap sprays out of them, and then it just had a giant Manus arm.
Like, kind of like the snake guys in Bloodborne.
Yeah.
Exactly. And first you fight them, and then suddenly they're these big.
Yes,
but I saw it as not so much like it looked almost like it was a. It took on like liquid.
Like
formation because
creature.
It sucked
it was like
up
tentacles. And
yeah,
stuff.
The enemies around it sucked up into it, and they started swirling around inside as if they were like struggling
Wait,
to get out.
It sucked up the nearby enemies.
Yeah, they had like three.
I didn't notice that. I just thought it killed them when it transformed. I didn't realize it like
I
sucked
saw
them.
Like, they were swirling. Cool. They were swirling around inside as if caught in like a tidal wave.
I mean, would you guys agree though? That seemed very like it was abyss.
Yeah, it was totally
a firm gelatinous cube.
Well, this is Peeve. This is something that you've talked about frequently when comparing demons. Souls and Bloodborne to the other two Souls games is that, what is it you say, the enemies in Demon Souls look like proper indescribable demons?
Yeah, that's one thing I liked about Demon Souls is that some of the enemies and most of the bosses you can't properly describe by anything other than saying it's a demon.
And this mini boss enemy that we saw was very much that.
Yeah,
it was like you take the centipede demon and cover it in oil and it's just like swirling. Yeah. And
well, it even had like the tracers like Manus, like with the eyes and the way like the particle effects came off of it.
The actual boss. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Dancer. Okay. There's a lot of people that want to know what was the boss of the
Dancer of the Frigid Valley.
Yeah, Dancer of the Frigid Valley.
Dancer of the Frigid Valley. Also, the area we were seeing was Wall of Lodolith, right?
Yes,
Wall of Lodolith.
Yeah, but yeah, so anyways, Dancer of the Frigid Valley. Because I noticed because it almost looked like Wardrin in a way, by the way, but it's not. It's trying to start the speculation.
When I first read it, I read it as Wall of Lol Death.
But yeah, so the boss though, like, it was like this gangly.
So it was a vaguely humanoid. Well, I mean, it was humanoid. Yeah,
as best
like
as you get.
In the same way that Gumby is humanoid. But it moved like super liquidy. Like its spine was.
It definitely had like a horror movie Japanese feel to the way it animated and moved. It was real goofy.
It constantly like had its head forward.
No guys, it was Knight in Armor. Let's just tell everyone. It was Knight in Armor boss, guys. It's just another Knight in Armor.
Except they wore metal armor and. Miyazaki actually made a point that even though the thing was wearing metal armor, it still moved like it was made of rubber.
Somebody on Reddit described it as like Voldo.
Voldo.
What's Voldo?
Voldo.
That's a perfect analogy.
I have a kind of Souls reference for it. It reminded me of the moon presence in Bloodborne.
Yes. Oh yeah.
The way the moon presence has those like it has that one like super delayed attack. Like that's what its attacks look like. They throw you off because you're like,
very
coming in. It's like, oh wait,
yes. One of the points that President Miyazaki emphasized when they were demonstrating it was that its movement patterns were unpredictable.
Unpredictable. Yes. Miyazaki said.
Oh yeah. Another thing too was that he pointed out was that this specific enemy would shoot fire every so often. And that was setting the actual environment on fire.
Oh, yes.
The ground caught fire. And then it had that ash sword, and it ran across the ground, and then a couple seconds later, an explosion came up from it.
I saw like a whirlwind of like ash or something come up at one point.
The fire also from its sword remained on the ground, and we couldn't see the HUD, but it seemed to be damaging the player.
Yeah.
There was also a dragon in the demo. And
how about that fire?
Said,
that fire looked badass.
Like the translator said that. He specifically wanted a dragon at like the start of the game or whatever.
He said his favorite thing is to put a dragon at the start.
What an evil also in a castle area where it's like gonna blow up your pathway with fire, which is what it was. It was like one of those. It was almost like the Demon Souls path in a way, where it's just
like you don't want to fight this at the start, but the dragon like clears the enemies in the other paths.
Yeah. Well, and there's also actually there were two dragons. One was dead. Right. The other one was alive. Just so if people are curious.
And the second dragon, the one that was alive, it had a little bit more complexity to the way that it breathed fire because there were two different paths and it would breathe fire on both paths.
It would change its.
It would swing left to right.
One very specific thing about that though is that didn't they say it was a stone dragon?
Yes.
That's
they
super.
Did say it was a stone dragon?
Yeah, it's extremely.
I thought it looked stone to me, but I wasn't sure and I just.
Yeah,
it looked like
a stone calamite.
I believe I remember that President Miyazaki, because I was paying attention to what he was saying. Not what Atsu was saying. Atsu was the translator who was translating it. I was paying attention to Miyazaki's Japanese because I knew everyone else would be paying attention to the English. If I remember correctly, I believe President Miyazaki used the term ishi, which is stone. So that would be a stone dragon in the original Japanese.
Yeah.
So that's back to Dark Souls 1.
Yeah, Dark Souls 1, Age of the Ancients.
Yeah.
Well, then again, wasn't whatever the hell his name was from the first DLC in Dark Souls 2 also stone?
Calamite?
No. Dark Souls 2.
Oh, Sin.
Sin, wasn't
no,
he
Sin
a
wasn't stone?
No, he was not stone.
He was just sleeping, man.
Yeah,
he was just sleeping.
When you have that much poison in your body,
he's very
you turn
stiff.
The body to
you. Tired.
Well, you sleep off, so he didn't wake up with a hangover.
Yes. Oh, actually, we should explain. Vadi is with us, but he was not able to be here for this podcast.
He's no
today.
Longer with us anymore.
That's normal. He's making his own like lore video right now.
Well, yes,
his impressions video.
The reason he is doing that and not with us right now is because he is very ill. He's not been feeling well. He's not gotten much sleep because he's not been feeling well. So he's back at the hotel recuperating, unfortunately. We wish he could have been here. He cannot. So just so everyone is not asking where he is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's another thing about the bosses, or at least the main boss. they specifically said that there were different levels of the boss.
Different
and
transitions.
You saw it whenever you brought out the second weapon. And
It's very much like Bloodborne.
The term President Miyazaki used in Japanese is the same term that FromSoft uses internally to refer to phases of boss fights.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's when you get a boss down to 50 or 60% HP, and then they go ham on you.
You know what it's like with Lords of the Fallen was trying to promote all their boss fights.
Yeah, but they gamified it so much.
Don't bring up Lords of the Fallen.
I think that's just going to be a typical thing for all their games.
Where you're sitting in Namco Bandai's offices, and you go and bring up Lord of the Fallen.
Let's restart that.
No, another thing a lot of people seem to be interested in was the bow, the way the bow functions now. It's more like
a short bow. The other bows are not that quick. Okay. Only the short bow.
He literally described it as like Lego loss. And yeah, I mean, he was shooting super fast. He was rolling and shooting almost instantaneously.
He rolled into an R1 shot with the bow.
Yeah. Rolling R1 with the bow.
Yeah, it was nice. Because the only weapons in the Souls games that don't have rolling attacks were like the projectiles.
The rolling R1 of the bow reminded me in Bloodborne, whenever you do like an unlocked shot. Whenever you like do a rolling shot with a gun, but you're like unlocked, you do like this fancy like on one leg kind of shot. Kneel.
That's what I'm saying, he was doing one where he would still be crouched in a roll. But I noticed that there was still a fairly decent recovery time, because I know a lot of people, as soon as they hear what you just said, is, oh, bows are OP, why not just make bow?
And it wasn't close quarters,
but
to be honest.
The shot came out very quick, and it seemed very reliable in all sorts of combat, but the recovery was still pretty slow, which is good. It isn't just like, you're not running around like, because Legolas is a bad example, because if you watch the goddamn movies, he's firing it like a machine gun. It's like, thum, 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 thum.
Yeah.
We don't want people to think that you can fire a bow like rapidly.
Well, I think what President Miyazaki was getting at with that, though, was that moving while shooting.
Right,
yeah.
It's like a primary
weapon.
But I mean, they had that in Dark Souls 2. You can move while shooting, but it just gets very slow.
But I brought up with people.
He wasn't sprinting and shooting.
It allowed it to be more like a prime.
You can actually make Dark Souls 2 comparisons, though. I think this is specifically, at least this is what I was thinking of, is that it has some of the good things that Dark Souls 2 did, like that, which is like, yes, you can walk around and run or move around with bows and still shoot, which is a really nice change. Honestly, watching this, I've never done a bow build, and this kind of made me want to do
a bow. Yeah, this is definitely the first time that I've ever seen a bow and been like, I want to try that. That looks fun.
The interesting thing about it is that they specifically told us, although they did not demonstrate a longbow, they said that the longbow worked very differently from the shortbow, and that you could not fire it while moving. That there were a couple of other.
He said you can't fire while moving.
Yes.
Yeah, he did say that.
Maybe that's why they were using the short bow at such close range. Maybe the short bow, a little like medium to long range.
He also said that the long bow would do more damage and it would be better for other purposes, but that the short bow had a faster rate of fire and you can shoot it while moving.
What's interesting about that is because in Dark Souls 1 you have like the composite bow and stuff, which is like, you know, master race of all the bows. And I always wanted to use like the long bow, but it's always better to use
reason.
If you're sniping differentiating them.
So we just so people don't ask or not just don't ask what you want, but I mean just so people know, we didn't get to see any magic. There just wasn't any
important. So in Dark Souls 1, the throne item mechanics were really addictive. I loved throw, like unlocking and just like whipping a firebomb like up into a window. And in Dark Souls 2, you threw items more like a shot put. Like your character would push out from the shoulder, and they always had a lob. You couldn't throw something straight down at the ground.
They were harder to target.
Exactly.
Much more
this
so.
Has the exact throw mechanics from Dark Souls 1. He was standing on a beam, and there were barrels below. Now in Dark Souls 2, you would have to lob the grenade up and make it land in the barrels. But he looked down with the camera and threw it like a baseball at the barrel.
Yes.
And that would lead me to believe if there are things like fireballs or whatever.
They have their
also
own
like
too.
Free throw those. Yeah.
Yes, and I imagine, because this is a problem that Bloodborne had, like you guys who do PvP are more aware of this than anyone else, that if you're trying to hit somebody with a numbing mist, screw you.
You're
it's going to go right over their head.
Well, and same with Lloyd's Talismans in Dark Souls 2. Like, Like, yeah. It wasn't, I mean, the size of the AoE sucked, but the problem was that you throw it like a bowling ball. Like, yeah. You throw it way high.
It had too much of an arc.
Yeah, you didn't throw it like a baseball.
Right.
You know.
Oh, I just realized something really important we should bring up, which is that when someone asked Miyazaki about Soul Memory, he almost didn't seem to even know what they were talking about.
No.
He laughed over Soul Memory.
Yeah.
Yeah, he turned around and laughed.
He laughed at the wall. And he's like, oh, yeah.
He's like, what?
Yeah, so he did say too, and he said it's going to be soul level.
But what they did though, they did say they were going to use that, and then as their base or whatever.
Right.
I don't remember exactly what the wording was, but it was like
the wording
to expand upon that.
The wording was that they would be, and he specifically mentioned soul signs. Soul signs are going to be used for summoning now, he says, and also that they are going to.
Hey,
welcome. Thanks, Jay.
So Lobos has just arrived for anybody in the podcast.
I think we have about two more minutes.
There's about three more minutes.
So, yeah, so the multiplayer mechanics, they didn't want to talk too much about them. Several people specifically asked, but he said that they were still largely in flux. He did confirm, however, soul level-based matching and some tweaks, which, in my mind, probably is going to be a password system like Bloodborne. That's just a guess, but I don't know why they wouldn't bring that back.
And one thing I did notice, and I don't know if anyone else noticed, whenever he attacked with the scimitar with the totem attack, the enemies didn't bunch up and line up in one direction. They came from every direction.
They spread out.
They were surrounding you like at that point. Whenever he attacked, I don't know if they came from different directions, but they actually were.
Oh, you mean like their AI might have caused them to specifically swarm you?
Like strategically.
But a few times he did line enemies up.
The dragon came down, it lined it up.
You know what? Something I noticed though was like before he went to go fight the dragon, he went to a group of enemies and aggroed them, and then ran away up a staircase towards where the dragon was located, and the enemies didn't chase him.
I think that was just that the situation.
Just to show that off.
I think it could also be
alpha stuff, which is not.
Yeah. He specifically was like, see all those guys back there? They're angry.
I think Dark Souls has a bunch of situations where it's teaching you some tactics. And I think those enemies specifically had a shorter like aggression range because a new player comes in, they run up, they're like, oh my god, there's all these enemies, backpedal, let's go up the stairs. You go up the stairs expecting the enemies to chase you, see a dragon, you come back down the stairs and the enemies have wandered off. And I think that's just to teach you that, you know, you can use the environment to kill the enemies and all that stuff. Like, I think normally enemies are going to have a much longer aggro.
I was gonna say, since Lobos is like joining late, was there anything you wanted to touch upon specifically?
I got nothing. I liked what I saw.
Chime in if we bring something up, because I wanted to touch upon Ty's point very briefly. One of the other things that President Miyazaki emphasized and repeated several times was that they're aiming for a graduated series of challenges that are fair, but that scale the farther through the game you go. So, I completely agree with Ty that while the early encounters in the beginning areas may be intended as more educational experiences, later on, we can probably expect things to be much more hardcore.
Yeah, like crazy ambushes and enemies chasing you for like a long time.
There was a lot of ambushes too.
I mean, we saw some crazy stuff just in the demo area with that enemy that transformed from a bunch of little ones into a huge one. That unexpected stuff like that, if that's the precedent, I think this is going to be pretty...
Well, one of the things that I noticed is it really reminded me about like level 1-1 and Demon's Trap. But for a lot of reasons, you have these kind of little kind of crappy enemies, little dragons, whatever. But then there's this huge focus on these individual knights that are just ridiculously fast.
Like the red knights from
rather than having like a million stupid enemies, just ambush the crap, just all this crap.
And then keep on using that mechanic over and over and over again.
There's this more of like an interesting kind of 1-on-1 or 2v1 with an actually tough enemy because it's fast.
That red knight was really aggressive.
Well, speaking of the 2v1, because we saw them demonstrate against an enemy that looked very much like the Merenica Knights of Dark Souls 1, but behaved very much like the Red Eye Knights of Demon Souls. About the same size as the Merenica Knights, they used large shields. One had a great sword, the other had a spear. The spear one used the exact same multi-hit running thrust that the Red Eye Knights had from Demon Souls.
Oh, wait, did?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
But he also had a lot more to it as well.
Yeah, they had much more complexity.
I did see, and they were switching between one and two-handed.
Yeah, he two-handed the spear and did like a, what was it, like the...
he can do the same.
Yeah, he was even switching into the chances that we have.
And enemies heal.
They were chuggers, man.
Can we talk about like PvP healing? Like now it's just Dark Souls 1...
Oh, the Estus was super fast, like just exactly like that.
Yeah, well, but you couldn't even tell, like, you didn't see the UI, so you don't know how fast. You could just be like, clunk, and then it's just like, slow.
True, we don't know how much it was healing. With no HUD.
Yeah, the healing looked like Dark Souls.
And for the record, because I know a lot of people have been asking, we said there's no HUD, but we also saw no inventory, nothing about stats, nothing.
We only saw one HUD element at all, which was the gesture menu.
Oh yeah!
Oh yeah! He praised the sun.
He praised the sun. I mean, that's pretty.
I noticed the gesture menu. This is
Bloodborne-esque. It wasn't the same type of
character on it. I think was like a hollow, like doing all gesture. I know it doesn't matter.
Can we also like say too? Like that. I mean, some of the stuff too. He said very specifically, it's still in the alpha stage. So forgive us. It's still alpha stage.
There's probably a lot of placeholder and a ton of unfinished stuff.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So it's like kind of hard to say, especially like I mean, this is a closed door thing.
There's a reason why they don't want to show it to the public. Yeah. It's
and they
but it still looked great despite.
It looked
awesome.
To me, I didn't really see anything except that one ragdoll that Ty was about to bust out laughing. Ragdolls are back because one of the enemies got stuck like upside down in the ground while Miyazaki's talking, shaking his butt all jello in here, and Ty almost busted out laughing and interrupted Miyazaki.
Yeah, but besides that, it was like, yeah, this looks ready to ship.
That's not a bug, it's a feature.
That is a feature, I'm just saying. It looked really good, but that was the one thing that made us like...
It was definitely the most solid early preview for this type of thing that we've seen in a very long time.
Absolutely, yeah, for sure.
It looked like finished product.
Because you didn't look at it going, oh, that looks a little weird, oh, looks real. Well, they'll clean it up when they're done with the game.
But to be fair, Bloodborne looked... Then its first iteration looked amazing.
The NT, you mean?
Yeah, like the very first thing we saw Bloodborne was like just mind blowing.
The environments, looked just as detailed as Bloodborne.
Yeah, yeah. Definitely. Yeah,
it looked like Bloodborne with castles.
But with the full color palette, and it was during the day, it was like a sunrise.
It was so much brighter.
Faded sun.
Speaking of the sunrise, though, you can point out, like, look at the faded sun. It's faded. Like, that's something
else. It looked amazing, like the clouds in the sky.
But I mean, I think he was saying it like as a lore thing.
Right. Yeah. That was obviously important to him to point out.
Yeah, that
it had a significance.
Yeah.
The other thing that's worth noting is, one of the other things, is that the art style itself, because I think a lot of people are going to be interested in this as well, the art style does not go the route that Bloodborne did, obviously. It doesn't have quite that really dark, gritty, dirty feel to it. But it's by no means whitewashed or sterilized. The environments, while they are very definitely high fantasy rather than Lovecraftian or Gothic, there is a very striking amount of darkness to some, especially the indoor areas of these environments.
Well, it's just what we saw for the demo thing.
Right, but still, I mean, that's a thematic choice as much as render settings.
As far as polish, one thing I do want to mention is those crazy nights that we were talking about earlier, the armor was super shiny, and the dynamic lighting on the armor looked freaking incredible.
And I don't know if anybody noticed, but whenever it was like Bloodborne-esque, whenever the more enemies you kill and stab, he started to slowly get blood on his armor.
Yeah.
I noticed the blood splatter.
It wasn't very shiny. It absorbed in the cloth and the armor.
It wasn't like Bloodborne where after one big fight you're just covered in blood.
And also, like, as far as that's concerned too, when he was killing enemies, I didn't really notice blood.
It wasn't like they weren't exploding with blood.
I noticed blood.
I thought the blood looked exactly like blood.
Yeah, it was very.
I thought the blood spray was like,
and then on the ground, they would be like you know, splatter.
Yeah, I thought it looked almost the exact same.
I thought I saw like a cloud, but maybe
I
just saw.
After a big fight, like you and the environment are completely coded.
Well, not the environment. I'm talking about the actual animation from your strike. It reminded me of the projectiles,
even the
blood
amount?
Spray. Yeah, it looked just like Bloodborne.
I mean, it's a little toned down from Bloodborne.
Slightly.
That was the point of that game, but you know, it was still very much like sideways, horizontal spurt that goes like almost all across the screen.
Oh, right.
But then most of the animations that I did, like whenever I did notice, it was the scimitar. And yes, he's spinning, so the blood will. So it had.
Okay. I'm sorry. There's one thing I really want to touch upon before we're like out of time.
Okay.
It was. I noticed with the swirling thing that came up and like sucked up all the enemies, it made me realize that it's possible in this, I don't know, this lore mechanic or what, but it's possible that it might be like Dark Souls 1 kind of where, you know, you have your hollows and everything, but rather than it just being hollows, it's almost like, it seemed that one enemy kind of made me feel like it seems like the world is like being overcome by dark and corrupted. Because even the enemies were like surprised by it, you know, by the way they got
only cinders remain, man.
So it's almost like two kinds of enemies coming in.
Guys, somebody is informing us that we need to vacate the conference area. We've already overstayed our welcome. So listen, everyone, thank you so much for joining us for the podcast. We hope you've enjoyed it. We hope it's been informative. And as soon as we all get back to our respective homes, we will be resuming our uploads as usual.
Bye-bye!
Bye-bye! Rainbow smelter confirmed.
Bye-bye!
Please, no. Aerial dragon slayer, it's a thing.